Okay, so hello everyone. I'm sorry for the delay. So I'm coming live from a different account, so there is some technical issues. Just give me 1 minute, it'll be sorted out. Okay. Just 1 moment, everyone. Yeah. Okay, good. So let's begin the session. I apologize for the delay. There were some technical issues. I hope my audio and video are clear. Right? Okay. Fine. So let's begin with our positions. Okay, so the first position we have on the screen. So today, Grandmaster Magesh Panchanathan was supposed to explain the training positions for group 1, and I was supposed to do for group 2 to 4. But he became a father just yesterday, so he's not in a position to do that. So I'll be explaining on his behalf. So the first position for the training game. This is the game between Frank Marshall versus Capablanca, played in 1909. And just give me 1 minute. Let me try to log into our channel as well. Harsh or Vansh, can you please give me the YouTube channel link? So I will... One moment, friends. Yeah, okay, good. So if you have any questions, you can input on chat. I'll be able to watch it. Okay, so Sai Krishna says he won this position as white and drew as black. Okay, fine. So now I can read your chat messages. So if you have any doubts, please let me know. Okay, fine. So let's go to the position. Here it is black to play. Now let us first try to understand the position well. Here we have central majority. White has central majority. Maybe I'll flip the board. Yeah, white has central pawn majority. Now if you look here, 3 versus 3 on the king side. On the queen side, it is 3 versus 2. So black has queen side pawn majority. And in the center, it is 1 versus 0. Right, white has central pawn majority, and in general, central pawn majority is good to have in middle game, and flank majority like queenside pawn majority, it is better to have it in end game. Now, why do they say that flank majority is good to have in end game? Is because generally in most of the games, both sides would have castled on the king side, isn't it? So both sides would have castled on the king side, and then when one of the side has a queenside pawn majority and we reach an end game, and let's say one side starts advancing the pawns, queenside pawn majority, then the king will be far away to block the pawn, isn't it? Instead, if I have a pawn majority and I start advancing here, the king will be well placed to block my pawns. So that is a simple reason why it's better to have a flank majority in the end game. Whereas it is good to have central majority in the middle game. Why? When you have a pawn majority in the center and if you are able to advance it quickly, then what happens is the you will be pushing back all the black pieces backwards. When the pawn advances, it will drive the black pieces backwards, they can become passive, and one of the pieces will be forced to block the passed pawn, and it becomes a passive piece in the process. So that is why it's good to have central pawn majority in the middle game. From that aspect, you can say we are still in the middle game, so white should be better. The pawn is also under attack, and you can exploit your pawn majority. But in this case, what happens, even if white manages to advance the pawn to e5, it just becomes weak, and it does not push any of my pieces backwards. Okay, so basically the whole debate is about whose pawn majority is able to advance and create troubles for the opponent. So this is what the whole position is about. So the currently we can see the pawn is under attack. Even if white manages to take the pawn, you can always play rook b8 and rook into b2. So for example, I'm just saying, like, even if I make a move like this, I'm not losing any big material because, let's say, something like this. And even if you get this pawn, ultimately 3 versus 4 on the same side should end in a draw. Okay? 4 versus 3 versus 4, same side, it should ultimately end in a draw. White can push, but very tough to win. Mostly it will end in a draw. So you can say black is not worse. From this small variation, you can already understand that black is not worse. Okay, so black played rook b8. Now, with rook b8, what are we trying to do? Okay, so with rook b8, what are we trying to do? We are trying to advance our pawns. Okay, now the other rook can come behind the c pawn, and then the pawns will be in a position to advance. So this rook, even though it looks passive currently, once the pawns start moving, it will be rook behind the passed pawn. Okay, how about the white rook on a1? The pawn on a2 is under attack, and as a result, the rook is tied. And whichever pawn move you make, it can produce some new weaknesses. Okay, so let us see. So here he played queen e4. Now the idea is to play bishop h3. Now whenever you are playing for a draw, then it makes sense to transpose the game into major pieces in game. Like preferably if you can go to a rook and pawn in game, because Tarash said all rook and pawn links are drawn. He does not really mean all rook and pawn links are drawn when he says rook and pawn links are drawn. He simply stresses the drawing nature of rook and pawn links. Okay, so from that angle, white realizes that black can quickly advance his pawns, create a pass pawn, and he wants to transpose the game into some major piece in game. So instead of now playing a move like b5, allowing bishop h3 and exchanging the bishop and reaching the major pure major pieces in game where the defending side it is easier to make a draw, so what black does, he pays attention. He asks himself, why did this guy move the queen? So he sees the threat, and what he does, he moves the queen away. Now in this way, what happens, he is getting out of this pin, so preventing bishop h3 exchange. But the problem is, you are willingly going in front of the rook. Generally we are not supposed to do this. Okay, generally this is not the correct way to play, but here the problem is, even if he does this, we are getting a protected passed pawn. Okay, so for this reason, black was happy to temporarily go in front of the rook. But generally, I would advise not to go for such things. And now, white, what he should have done, he has pawn majority in the center, right? So he should try to advance his pawns. So even initially, what he could have done, for rook a8 instead of playing queen e4, he could have considered this, followed by queen e3, and then start rolling the pawn. Okay, this is what ideally he should have done. But instead of using his pawn majority, he is busy playing some other moves. Okay, so he played rook c3. So what we should realize is, we should play on the side where we are strong, and we should not play where our opponent is strong. It doesn't make sense, right? If our opponent is strong in one side, it generally means we are weak on that side. Similarly, if we are strong in some side, our opponent most likely is weaker on that side. So from the pawns, you can say black has a strength on queen side, because I have 3-2-2 majority, which is easy to defend. I'll have all my pieces on the queen side, right? So it is black who should be playing on the queen side. But what is white doing? He is also playing on the queen side. So if both white and black play on the same side, then generally whoever is better on that side will benefit. Okay, so by playing rook c3, white is thinking, I am attacking black pawns, I'm not letting them move, but this move will actually help black, because when the pawns come rolling, it will come with a tempo. So now he plays a reactionary move, stopping b4 with tempo, but c4. So now he's going to come. So you see, quickly black is able to use his pawns and advance. So as the pawns advance, you can see that white is becoming on the defensive. Now what about the extra pawn white has? It is not being put to use, right? It's just watching the whole game as a spectator, and this is not what we should be doing. Understood? Okay, so here he played a3 c4 and now he plays some bishop f3. Probably he is still dreaming about this exchange, because if you play f5, queen e6 check will happen. So brings the rook to the open file. He could have played a5 as well, no problem. So he comes rook d1, rook d1, bishop d1. Again, this is possible. Plays rook d8, capture the open file. And sometimes this king can come under an attack as well. So played bishop f3. Now again, you can push your pawn, but there is only one weakness in black's position. That is the back rank. So he plays g6. Now there is a small question. If I want to clear my back rank, should I play h6 or g6? Right? And generally we will think we should not keep our pawns on the same color as opponent bishop. So we would prefer to play something like h6. But what did black do? He played Capablanca, he played g6. Now generally what I tell my students is, when you want to make pawn moves, you should try to put the pawns in the same color as opponent bishop. Okay, so he has white color bishop, so the pawns near the king. Okay, please understand, I am not talking about the other side pawns. The pawns in front of the king, near the king, they should be kept in the same color as opponent bishop. So that way the bishop will not have any target to attack. Okay, so let us imagine if this is a dark color bishop. So let us say the white bishop is actually here on d4 square. Okay, so if I keep all my pawns in opposite color, he will be in a great position to punish my dark square weaknesses, isn't it? So this we should be careful about. So that's why he played g6. So you see, when you have a long term advantage, now this pawn majority is not going to disappear in the next one or two moves, right? It is going to be there for a long time. So it means black has a long term advantage. This advantage is not short term. So whenever you have long term advantage, okay, you should not rush things. You should play a gradual game, a slow game. Understood? When you have long term advantage, don't be in a hurry. Play slowly, because your advantage is not going to disappear in the next few moves. It's going to be there with you for a long time to come. So how we should play slowly? Whatever small improvements you can make in your position, do it. Whatever small weaknesses you have in your position, try to get rid of them. So one weakness was back rank weakness, so we are eliminating. And if there is any good moves by opponent, prevent it. So these three things we should do. Okay, when you have long term advantage, what we should do? We should try to prevent opponent's good ideas. If it is a bad idea, don't prevent it, encourage it. So if your opponent has a good idea, prevent it. If you can prevent it, that is one. Second, whatever weaknesses you have, take care of them. So here he had a back rank weakness, he is eliminating the back rank weakness. Okay, and whichever bad pieces you have, either improve it or exchange it. Okay, so here he played queen c6, he's trying to exchange the queens. Now you can take queen into c6, bishop into c6, a6. But then probably he'll come bb7, you can still go rook d6. White should be, black should be fine. But this is a nice move. It defends the pawn and also centralized. Right? Queen is very centralized. And suddenly what you can do, you can create some mating attack against the king also. This is possible. Okay. And the other thing, you are going to go rook d2, which will attack the b2 pawn. And it won't be easy to defend the b2 pawn. And the queen can do something like this, queen f6 or queen here, both the bishop and f2 will be hanging. Understood? So I'm going to play rook d2 followed by, let's say, queen f6, and then you can never take queen to b5 because f3 will be hanging, and you can never move the bishop because f2 will be hanging. Okay, so you see white's black's pieces are centralized. You see all the pieces are on the e and d file, centralized, and they are going to enter the position. Okay, so it is going already very tough position for black. So again he goes back. So why he is expecting the queen to go back, but no. Now you can play rook d2, but rook c2 is coming. Right? So what he did, he first gave rook d1 check. Okay. king g2, and now a5. So he is going to first advance the pawns. This weak pawn is not going anywhere, right? He cannot move the pawn. We'll simply capture. So he plays rook c2, b4. Okay, this pawn is going to be in big trouble. So the position is already like close to winning. Now we are going to push. Okay, so he comes here anyway, push. Okay. And finally this idea, rook c2. It's over. So he plays here. Now there is a small tactic possible, which is c3, bc3, b2. Now if you take on this, piece is lost. Okay, and white, black won the game. Very nice game. Here the main theme was black's passed pawn was black made use of his pawn majority and started rolling the pawns. Whereas white spawned extra pawn, which was the central majority, he did not make use at all. Both sides played where black is strong, so black won the game. So this is something you should learn. Now let's go to the next example. Okay, so here black just white just sacrificed a knight with knight f5. It is black to play. Okay, now the question is, can you accept the piece, extra piece, and become a piece up or not? Is it safe or not? This is the question before us. Okay, so generally what happens, there are some players who are afraid of giving sacrifices, such sacrifices. Now let's say your knight was on g3 and you see this idea knight f5 and it looks like you are getting some good attack. Will you have the courage to play it? Knowing is something, but actually doing it's completely different thing, right? If you see Michael Tal giving this sacrifice, we will say very good. Right? But when we get the same position and we have to play the same sacrifice, we panic, right? So and similarly what happens is when our opponent is sacrificing material, then we make the mistake of trusting him wholeheartedly. We think if he is sacrificing, he must have seen something, otherwise it is working, otherwise he wouldn't sacrifice just like that. So we simply refuse to question his sacrifice, whether it is good or bad. So the correct refutation is you have to take it. Now you have taken it. Now what did I say in the previous position? You should not play where you are weak. You should play where you are strong. Is black strong on the king side? No. So black should not be making moves like this, like f6 kind of thing. We should not be playing where we are weak. Okay. So look at this knight. What is it doing? Nothing. Look at this rook. Doing nothing. Right? Even this rook. Ideally, this rook should be on e8. Right? This rook may be on b8. So black's pieces are not very active, and these pawns can come forward, and then the queen can come to h5, create a mating attack on h7, right? This is his idea. He wants to play f6 followed by queen h5, queen h7 mate, something like this. Now in such situations, what many players do, we start defending on the king side because our king is coming under attack, and this we should not do. Okay, instead what you should do, you should try to create your own counterplay. So you should play knight c5, and it looks like it's going to be big trouble for black, but this move. So you see, we have every right to give back the extra material to keep our king safe. Okay, so he sacrificed a piece, white sacrificed a piece, we accepted it. But once we realize our king is coming under danger, we should happily give back the extra piece. Okay, so now the bishop c2 is not playing any part in the attack. Rook a1 also not playing any part in the attack. The knight cannot come. Okay, because the square is controlled. So it's not easy for the white pieces to go to the king side and create an attack. So at the right time he is giving back the extra piece. So he played here. So now he's still hoping to attack the h7 square. So he wants to come queen h5, then bishop into e5, and then rook h4, something like this. He's trying to attack this point. This is the weakest spot in black's position. So black saved the piece. He's continuing with his attack. Now he wants to take, followed by rook h4, queen h7, mate. Okay, so he calmly puts the knight here. Now this rook h4 will never come, isn't it? Knight at h4. And this bishop diagonal will never be opened because the knight is blocking here. So black defended against all threats. So he moved. And now this. Now this also is pinned. Okay, and white has the extra piece, black has the extra piece, and is going to play rook e8, include all pieces, and then it's over. So white's attack was simply refuted by black by taking the bull by the horns. So we should not trust our opponent's attack blindly, and playing on the side where we are weak is not correct. We should play where we are strong. So you see, at this point he did not try to defend. White black did not do anything in this area, right? Because this is the area where white is trying to attack black. So what he does something else, right? And white is playing in this area because that is where he is strong, and where we are playing, where we are strong. This is very important. In chess, you should be ready to lose in one area so that you can win in the other area. Okay, so now this is under attack. So he played rook e4, bishop f8, queen h5, knight g6, all attacks beaten back, and he won the game. Okay, so let's go to the next position. So these are the two positions that was given for group 1. Now I'm going to go to group 2, 3, 4. So for group 2, 3, 4, the following two positions were given. So this was the position. Let me flip the board. So here black just played e5. Now the knight is under attack. Now what will we generally try to do? We will try to find a way to save the knight, and there is only one good square. So most likely we will play a move like knight b3, right? Or we may take and then play knight b3, isn't it? We will do one of these two things because these are the most natural and obvious thing to do. That's how it looks. But let us see who benefits more by this exchange. Now, one, I can take with the knight. I get a good outpost. Even though this knight is temporarily hanging, the bishop f3 is blocking the knight, right? So next move, I will just develop my bishop and castle. And this knight on e5 looks like a gold, right? Very strong. So I'm not sure why it benefits from this exchange. And if you go back, he will simply move the bishop and then castle. And his knight is already exerting, bishop is exerting pressure on this pawn. And the knight c5 can come, rook e8 can come. And there will be a lot of pressure on the e4 pawn. So that is why white did not take fe5. White did not move the knight also. So what else can be done? It looks like there is nothing else can be done, right? So in the opening, what you are supposed to do? Very basic principle, develop your pieces. When a piece is under attack, what is he doing? He is calmly developing a piece. Okay, so this is something we should learn. Now, if he takes the knight, what happens? Ed4. Now we take bd4. Now it looks like black simply lost a piece. White simply lost a piece. But what are we trying to do here? We are trying to play e5 and then e6 or ed6. Okay, so if I try to block this king and queen, okay, what happens here? I'll play e5 still. Now you have two moves. You can play d5 or you can play bishop f3, isn't it? Now if you play bishop f3, I take with queen. Now your knight is under attack, your rook on e8 is also under attack, and white will get back his piece, isn't it? And the king will be caught in the center. Okay, So this does not look good. And for e5, if it takes d5, you can simply take fe5. Now you are not able to take knight e5. And again, if you take bishop f3, queen f3, this under attack, also f7 also under attack. If you move the knight, I can also take queen f7. So I'll get back my piece. And if you move the knight, let's say I have this. Right? Big problems for black. Okay, so why suddenly the position is exploding? Because white was willing to sacrifice a piece for attack because he had a big lead in development. All 8 pieces have been developed in move 13. We are in move 13. White has developed all 8 pieces. And look at black. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 pieces out of 8 not developed after move 13. So if you have to punish opponent's incorrect play in the opening, the best way to do it is by taking some risk by opening up the center. And for that, you should be ready to take some risk. That is what white was willing to do. Now, if you try to play bishop g7 and run away this side, what you can do? You can still play e5. Now, if you take bf3, queen f3, same problem. Rook under attack, knight under attack. He can't save both. You'll get back your piece. And if you take, I take. Okay? And now, if you go knight where? Let's say here. Now e6, bd4 will come with check. Okay? So you could just take this. And now knight e4. Idea knight d6 check cannot be stopped. Queen. Also, rook f7 mate. Right? If you move the queen now, I'll play knight d6 check and rook into f7. It's over. The attack is too powerful. Right? I'm threatening knight d6 check, rook into f7 or knight f7. So this is very powerful attack. So that is why white calmly played rook d1. And now, if you say, okay, I understand. If I take, e5 is coming. So I won't take. So let me develop castle. And anyway, the knight is going to be under attack. You will have to defend your knight anyway. So what is the point? It is like I force you to play knight b3 anyway. Maybe one move later. So I'm still succeeding in pushing the knight back. No. The problem with this move is it weakened the d6 pawn. Its support is lost. So you can go here. Beautiful, no? Now, you also have to keep the knight under bishop under support. So let's say you go here, check. Okay, and now you have some interesting ways. You can go queen c4, attacking f7. Okay, basically, this king has to be attacked. But who can attack this king? If I have this diagonal something. If I have a bishop or queen here, then it will be good. So I can consider playing queen c4. It looks like I'm attacking the pawn, but I'm actually threatening to do this. And suddenly you see the king can come under big attack, right? So this is possible, but he has bishop d5. He can give back the piece. Okay. And now if I take e5, he can take queen. Suddenly the king becomes safe. Now, if you take, I can take with the knight. So, suddenly the king becomes safe. Now, I will move my rook and because I have to waste some time moving my queen, and then the rook comes out and the king becomes safe. Okay, so for this reason, we should not play queen c4 because the brilliant bd5 and the knight d6 is lost. So, we can play queen d3. Okay, now the idea is queen a3. Okay. Now, if you play bd5 like before, my queen is not under attack. So I can first move my knight. Now I'm going to take this happily because I am simply getting equal piece free attack. So you have to move the bishop and now queen check. The king is still coming under tremendous attack. Okay, so now if you go here, now again knight d6 threatening knight f7. So this is very strong attack. right? I'm also threatening to play fe5. Okay, so if you do something like this, I can take. Okay, very powerful attack, and black white should be winning. So this is the correct move. Understood? So you see, when in the opening, when something is under attack, we don't necessarily have to play defensive. Now let's go to the final position. I don't know how many of you saw rook d1. Now let me go to the final position, training position game. So here white just played b5, and black has to defend. This was the work that was given. How do we handle this? Now it's not an easy way to defend. So now if I play knight e7, then I have knight and d7. Now if queen e7, then rook a7 is coming, and this pawn is quite dangerous, and this pawn is also weak. Like if you play queen, rook into queen f6, rook d6 is coming. Okay, so you can see black is under pressure. Okay, so he did not play knight e7. If knight d8, I still have like rook a7, rook b7, b6, and again this pawn is creating a lot of problems for black. His position becomes very passive. So we can see that moving the knight allows rook a7, b6 ideas, and black is not getting any counterplay. So what black did is very interesting. He took this. Now if you take my knight, I will take back, right? No problem. So we have to worry, and if he takes with the bishop, I can take this pawn. Once I eliminate the b pawn, I can breathe freely. So the main thing we have to consider is this. Now the knight is under attack again. Okay, so now we move the knight. But what is the problem with this? What's the problem if we take on b5 and move the knight? The main problem is queen e5. But actually, this is not the best move. You should simply go back. And even though it is equal pawn and opposite color bishops, because of this pass pawn and because of this weak pawn, white still keeps some advantage. He can still play for win. Okay, but this looks more easy, right? You can exploit the pin and win a pawn. Okay, it looks like white is winning easily. But, and Karpov played this against Svechnikov in 1973. He did take the pawn. But let us see how black survives. Now this position looks hopelessly lost because of the extra pawn and the pass pawn. I mean, even if you pull the bishop back, it looks like blacking will be safe, and the b5 pawn is simply an extra pawn. And not only that, white is threatening to double the rook, and if the knight moves, rook at some checkmate. So it looks like black's position is completely lost. But black had found a very interesting resource, which is this. Now first, it prevents rook a7. Second, it is threatening knight b6 family fork, attacking everything. Now what is the only way to save the bishop, rook and the b pawn? There is only one move, which is this. Okay. Now if I play this, he can come here. When I take knight c4, he can take rook c4, and this rook defends the pawn. Okay. So this is not a problem. I can also consider this, because if you take, then it's mate. Okay, so rook c7, it prevents knight b6. Okay, so again it looks like everything is fine for black. But so these two strange backward moves in chess, this backward moves are very easy to miss, okay, for strong players. And for lower rated players, they don't feel so bad when they move pieces black, so it's not very difficult. But for stronger players, moving pieces like this, it really, they have to lose something in their heart to play such moves. Okay, so he played bd8, rook attack, rook c6, now knight b6. Now if you come rook s1, I'll simply take knight c4 followed by rook into b5. Okay, there is no rook at sound. So he has to play only move to defend this. Now c4, rook c4. Finally, it looks like again white is still safely pawn up, rook behind the passed pawn. But now you see black played bishop to d6. Now what is the threat? Black is threatening rook d8 followed by rook d2 or rook d8 followed by rook d1 checkmate. Okay, so this rook d8, rook d2, rook d8, rook d1 is not an easy threat to stop. Now this rook cannot come, or rook cannot come and stop on time. So this entry on d2 or d1 is happening. So he has to play this. Now threat is rook d2. So it looks like on time he stopped the rook entry, and in the process he also improved his king position. So white looks like extra pawn, and white pieces are active, but it is black whose pieces are active. He played bishop a5. Now the rook is under attack. What to do? He has to move the rook back. Now check. So look, all the black pieces are getting active. So now he has two moves. Now if you go here, then I can attack like this. Okay, so he played king to e3. Okay, now the thing is, if you go king f3, bb6, knight e3, first I will play this move. Okay, now I'm going to give e4 check, king f4, rook f2 check. So you don't have king g3. That is the point of rook check. Okay, there is no defense. Okay, so he played king to e3, and now f4 check. Problems. Now if he goes king f3, bb6, this pawn is lost. So in the game he played king e4, rook into pawn, king into pawn, rook into, and then they agreed for a draw soon because it became equal pawns. So here black survived because he found a clever way to activate his pieces. So first he bought this knight c8 and then knight c8 followed by knight b6. Okay, and then the rook bishop, he brought it bd8, which was passive, but immediately he came bb6, subsequently he played bishop a5. Okay, and then he brought the rook. So black survived mainly because of his activity. Okay, he understood he had an option to play with equal pawns, something like this. Right, he could have played with equal pawns, but all pieces passive and defensive. Okay, but he would have had probably no chance to survive this. Instead, what he chose to do, he chose to temporarily sacrifice a pawn. Queen e5. He chose to become a pawn down, but he calculated this line well, and suddenly his pieces came to life. Right, his pieces became active. So this is what we should learn from this example, that if you keep your pieces active and your king reasonably safe, that will usually compensate a pawn deficit. Okay, so this is what I call as active defense. Whenever you are in trouble, don't try to play with passive pieces but a pawn down. Instead, try to become a pawn down but keep your pieces active. That is a better way to try to survive from a difficult position. Okay, so thank you very much everyone. So those of you who are not members of Pro Chess Training, you can seriously consider becoming a member. You can visit our website www.prochesstraining.com. We have around 30 grandmasters who are teaching in our platform. Almost all the top Indian coaches and grandmasters are in our platform, along with other international grandmasters like Kazim Zanov, Shiro, Nisipiano, and many others. So I hope you all enjoyed the session, learn some useful things. Please subscribe to our channel and visit our website for more information. Thank you very much.